Welcome to the subcommittee of the Health and Human Services Committee. We have one bill on our agenda today, House Bill 520. It's for a hearing only. We're not voting on this bill today. The hearing is being live streamed on the legislative website, and it's also visible on the TVs outside of the committee room. We're going to have the bill presented, starting with Representative Jones, Sherman Jones, and Representative Oliver. Okay, the floor is yours.
Can you hear me? Okay, perfect. Thank you very much, Madam Chairwoman. Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. I appreciate that, and I appreciate the opportunity, as does Representative Oliver, to present House Bill 520 to you today. Sections 10 and 11 are effectively mirrors of each other, one regarding mental health and one regarding substance abuse. Moving on to Section 14 and 15. Surprised that the pushback on 14 and 15, because this is essentially the exact same language of 43-35-5.1. I'll say that reference one more time, 43-35-5.1, that went in 2010, including the entity language around immunity. In 2010, we put it in for the doctors. In 2023, what we're asking for is to put this in for mental health professionals and nurses. Effectively, from a workforce development standpoint, and I'll just use, and this is just an example, a 35-year-old nurse gets addicted to OxyContin. We would like that nurse to somehow stay in the workforce once they get rehab, not lose their license forever. This allows them to be able to go to the licensing board and basically admit that they are addicted. They probably get their license, if they do get their license, suspended, and then they go through rehab and they go through testing, et cetera, 90 days, 120 days, whatever is prescribed by the doctor, and then ultimately the entity will prescribe back to the licensing board a recommendation of whether or not they should get their license back or not. Let me be clear. 2 years from now, if that nurse does something wrong, or that nurse does, you know, in terms of at least an assumption of malpractice, all the information is absolutely discoverable inside of any type of court proceeding. Given best practices, commercial best practices, what type of information could you provide to the community to help them understand what would be the, I'll say, first indicators or second indicators of mental health or substance abuse? Madam Chairwoman, that is the end of my comments.
Thank you, and I know you're going to have to leave, but we're going to go ahead, Representative Oliver, if you could cover the other sections, and then if you're willing to take all the questions, that'd be great.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm very happy to be here, and I appreciate the privilege of presenting another opportunity for the state to move forward on mental health reform.
Let me just remind you, we're going to limit individuals to 2 minutes just because we've got a long list of people signed up, and we may not get to everybody today, and we'll get started. Okay, Hank Sullivan.
First of all, thank you for the opportunity. Second of all, came all the way down here from Cumming for 120 seconds of airtime, which I think is really unfair. I'd like for everyone who is against this bill to please stand up. The most egregious part of this bill that I find is the fact that the lead sponsor for the bill owns a company who stands to benefit from its passing. That is because he owns a monitoring company that does monitoring that is described in the bill. He had the same monitoring described in 1013 last year, and thankfully, for the hard work of the Senate, that monitoring aspect was removed. But he stands to gain from this. He and his partners stand to gain from this bill passing, and he's putting funding, and he's putting grants in order to fund these different aspects of health.
Madam Chair, I wonder if that would be appropriate for his testimony to be when Chairman Jones is here.
Sounds a little bit unfair.
Chairman Jones had the opportunity to be here.
You have by choice.
Do you have line numbers in the building you're referring to?
Then you should have stayed.
Start his time again.
Yes. Yes.
You can
look at line numbers 551 through 558, 545 through 550. You're going to find that these line numbers deal with professional health care program, defining the professional health care program, and the fact that monitoring and rehabilitation of impaired health care professionals for the purpose of this, that, and the other thing. Impaired means the inability of a health care professional to practice and reasonably, with reasonable skill and safety to patients be by reason of illness or use of alcohol, drugs, narcotics, and chemicals. What he's done is he's defined what his product does, which is a monitoring device. It monitors biometrics as well as GPS. So he's defined in the bill what his particular device actually does that's patented. And he's marketed this to Tennessee. He's marketed, it's in three states right now. It's now in Paulding County and in Fulton County. And I'd like for my entire remarks to go to the committee if I could. All right.
Thank you. Thanks to everyone for coming down. Stay tuned, this is a long process. We're just the beginning of it. Thanks very much, we're adjourned. I'm going to start to do this.